watching the Urban Debate on Mirror Now. Just yesterday, the police in Pune arrested Ravindra Marathe, the current serving CEO of the Bank of Maharashtra, along with former chairman, executive director and several other bank officials for apparently colluding with the real estate developer D.S. Kulkarni to divert money and to cheat shareholders. Apparently, these bank officers colluded to give Mr. Kulkarni a loan against the business that was actually used to renovate his home. Now, this would not be the first team of bank officials who colluded to cheat and steal money. Remember Nirav Modi and the 13,000 crore rupees? Now, we were earlier told that this was the doing of two single employees, fairly low down in the pecking order, and one single branch, making it sound like a one-off incident. But just today, details from the bank's own internal 162-page probe report tells us that no less than 50 employees colluded over several years to allow Nirav Modi to get away. According to this report, and this is going to be really interesting, according to this report, Punjab National Bank officials, ranging from the clerk to the foreign exchange managers to the auditors, the heads of regional offices, 54 of them altogether, are to be collectively blamed for this colossal loss to the bank and to the country. The bank's international banking department and its IT division even delayed making their integration work complete in order to allow this scam to happen. So how do they expect us to believe that nobody knew of this? The Brady House branch in Mumbai, the branch from where this entire scam was masterminded and headquartered, sent only 2 out of 12 of its monthly reports last year to its regional office. But the regional office issued a compliance certificate nevertheless. None of the senior inspection officers reported anything adverse. The bank's import-export transactions went up 50% in 2017, and nobody in the bank even bothered to look into it, let alone investigate. In the weeks before his retirement, Gokulnath Shetty, the prime accused, used his personal email ID to reconcile massive forex transactions involving Nirav Modi, and this was completely overlooked by the bank's treasury department. Under the Punjab National Bank policy, no officer is to remain in one office or one branch for more than 3 years because they don't want that officer to form comfortable relations like Gokulnath had with Nirav Modi. But Gokulnath Shetty stayed at the Brady House branch for 7 years. Now that is impossible to do unless the PNB top management was in the know and was aiding and abetting. The other question we must ask is, can the RBI here claim complete innocence? The chief vigilance officer of Punjab National Bank emailed the RBI asking for a special investigation to be conducted off that Brady House branch, and that email was ignored as well. What's worse, the scams right now are rampant and chronic, and not just limited to the public sector. ICICI Bank, our second largest private sector bank, is currently dealing with an accusation against its CEO, Chanda Kochar, who's being investigated. Over the last 5 years, 23,000 bank frauds worth 1 lakh crore rupees have been reported. And who is the watchman who is napping on the job? According to the Banking Regulations Act, the RBI officers have the authority to inspect any bank at will, to call for special audits of any bank, and to order changes in management if they're uncomfortable with what is going on in the bank. So the question I ask tonight is this: has the RBI completely abdicated its responsibility of keeping our money safe? Joining me on the show, Ajay Dua, former Commerce Secretary, Narendra Bhasin is the former CMD of Axis Bank, Sriram Khanna, founder of Consumer Voice, Nasir Saleem is a banker and managing partner at Felix Capital, Ashwini Rana is the Vice President of the National Organization of Bank Workers and the Working President of Canara Bank Workers Organization, Gautam Mukherjee is a senior journalist, and Mr. Nand Kishore Garg is a leader with the BJP. I welcome all of you to this conversation and I thank you for your time. Mr. Ajay Dua, I will start with you. Good evening and thank you for giving us your time this evening. We've had
good evening.
Former RBI Governor Mr. Y.V. Reddy point out that maybe we're lacking at this point when it comes to regulation. Do you believe stronger regulation would have saved us some of this 1 lakh crore rupees that have been lost to scams?
While that might be true, that are constantly based on the experience acquired, the regulations must be reviewed and revisited. However, I think in the case of Punjab National Bank, for which we have this report, which Reuters has reported, and it's quoting the internal report of the Punjab National Bank, the issue seems to be much more of lack of compliance with the existing regulations rather than inadequacy of regulations. Larger picture, about which 20,000 frauds and a lakh of crores, 1 lakh crores being involved, about which the ex-RBI governor has commented, that might be true. But about the Brady House branch operation going undetected from 2011 till 2018, I think it's a clear case, as the internal report itself of the PND has reported, that it is a case of negligence, it's a case of omissions, it's probably a case of connivance also, right from the branch level at the clerical clerks in the branch all the way up. The report talks about till the regional level, but I fear that it could even go much higher to the headquarters of the branch, headquarters of the bank in Delhi. And that is something which is bothering me much more than the fact that the regulations need to be revisited to strengthen them going forward.
Well, Mr. Dua, my question to you then, my follow-up question is this. You said yourself that it is possibly, that you possibly think it goes up to the headquarters, but we haven't had any sort of arrests, any sort of questioning. No one from the senior management really has been pulled up for this. Two people, or fairly junior, in a branch office have been arrested, and that's it. Are we allowing a very wide berth when it comes to this sort of money, because it's public money? It's not, it's, you know, it doesn't really belong to anybody else except the taxpayer.
I think so. I would tend to agree with your assessment that we are probably only finding scapegoats rather than people who, even if they were not directly involved, who failed in supervising the operations of the of this branch, operations of the Bombay region, which has reported such huge spikes in its disbursements in the foreign exchange division. Look at it. The Brady House branch, where all it originated, has increased its turnover by 50% in a year. It's being treated as a star performer. No one is really going into it, saying how did it become a star performer? How did its disbursements increase so rapidly? If not just to find out fault, at least to find out how is that branch doing? Can that be a good practice to be followed elsewhere? If somebody had bothered to look at this entire operation of SWIFT, if the bank had followed, the branch had followed the rules, guidelines for integration of the SWIFT system with its own internal system, if the banks had followed that, the audit pointed out, the audit observations have to be complied with, had to be reported, nothing of this level would have acquired such magnitude. But there is a failure all through at the branch level, at the regional level, and I'm afraid even at the level of the internal auditors as well as the external auditors who are supposed to do branch reviews.
What about the RBI? Here's my question. What about the RBI? Narendra Basin, former CMD of Axis Bank, do you believe that the RBI is doing its job as it's supposed to? The RBI has three jobs. One is obviously to look at inflation and manage inflation through interest rates, which it does very well. Secondly is to regulate banks. And thirdly is to look at the rights of customers and look after the rights of customers. Let's look at that point number two, regulate the banking sector. Is the RBI truly doing its job at this point? Mr. Basin.
The RBI as a regulator, as per the Banking Regulation Act, they are supposed to do the concurrent audit, or they can, as you already said, that they can call the any bank or any branch for the investigation. But in this case, if we see the how the things have happened, it's a clear-cut case of operational risk, or we can say the complete failure of the technology as well. Because if nobody going to believe that if the SWIFT is one of the core banking system which they have not linked, and if they are now they are saying this is one of the things when in the manual days when we used to have a Forex, Telex system is there. So we used to have a 5 to 6 checks. Whenever any foreign remittance is coming, it has been checked by the Treasury, it has been checked by the Foreign Department. But this is just a transfer. SWIFT is basically that how the system has to be linked. So even the, I think this is one of the real failure. Not only the part of, first thing is the bank, because bank has to report to the what audit or external audit, internal we have to report. Yes, RBI also has to be there, but the things which is coming in the report yesterday, I think it's a clear-cut failure because technology failure is there, plus operational risk which we have forward in this case. So I think RBI has to be more strict, or RBI already in the last 2-3 years back when in Bangladesh, Reserve Bank of India, the same thing problem has happened. So RBI has given the guideline all the banks have to link the core banking system. But if the PNB, one of the largest banks, if they are not complying, so I think this is a clear-cut case of negligence both the way, because operational risk has to be taken on the front, because we are more on the reputation or maybe on the business. In case we want to increase the business, already rightly said that not for the case of business achievement, we cannot forget the operational risk. I think this is.
I don't know, Mr. Bazin. I feel like you're allowing people off the hook too easily. Mr. Sriram Khanna of Consumer Voice. Here's my problem with this. The RBI should have audited. The RBI should have known that something was wrong. It could not have known that nothing was wrong when there was this much money leaving the country, not from one bank, but from several banks. And it is the RBI's job. You can't turn around and say no, because whose money is this? This is taxpayer money. We know that the government of India is going to put more money into these loss-making, horribly run, badly managed banks. And the RBI is going to again look the other way. Again, we're going to lose money. Nobody's taking responsibility. So I refuse to accept system failure, technology failure, Sriram Khanna, because at the end of the day, it's my money we're talking about.
You see, I have a feeling that in recent years, as the economy and the business sector has expanded, the public sector banks, their control and management systems have been compromised, influenced by wealthy borrowers, where managers in complicity with owners of companies have tried to take advantage. And this advantage and the complicity of managers has not been effectively supervised and checked in time. So the regional, the management of the Punjab National Bank at the headquarters, their board, their regional management, as well as their branch management responsible. And of course, the RBI has powers for inspection of branches, and they are doing so. They are doing inspections of branches and looking at the practices of borrowing and lending money. Why did the RBI not have a system to examine this? So is there a dereliction of duty in the RBI? Is there negligence in the RBI, or there is also complicity? So all these questions have to be answered. The PNB report has revealed these 50 officials of PNB who are either complicit or negligent, or who abused their authority or helped in committing the fraud. They must be brought to book. Action should be taken against them. The banking action, the disciplinary action is there. The Central Vigilance Commissioner is in charge of the vigilance of public sector banks. There is a vigilance officer in each bank. What vigilance inquiries have ensued? Where there is criminality, the FIRs must be filed and people must be arrested and action must be taken. A signal must go out to the entire banking sector. You cannot rob public sector banks like this. And until that is done, I think the message will be there. You can still make money and you can do what you like with public money, and nobody will hold you responsible. As far as the RBI is concerned, I think it is important for the board of the RBI to give an explanation to the public of India as to why their supervision and inspection systems failed in this case, and where does the responsibility lie within the RBI chain of command, right from the governor to the regional people in charge of the Mumbai region of RBI. So these responsibilities must be discharged, otherwise public faith is going to be shaken. And I'm sorry to say, the finance ministry is playing with soft gloves with these people. They need to be hard. They are appointing people on the boards of these banks. What kind of soft people you are appointing on these boards who are allowing this to happen? And your ministry officials of the Ministry of Finance are sitting on every bank board. What are they doing? Are they sleeping? So it's not just the bank officials, but also government officials. They seem to be working hand in glove, and there's a huge amount of complicity and corruption is taking place. And the sooner this is cleaned up, the better it is. Four years of the BJP NDA government should have improved this. Unfortunately, at the end of 4 years, the system has got worse. And they are saying this is the problem of the previous years. They are still blaming the UPA government. I'm sorry, this is too late now. You have been in power for 4 years. You had enough time. Your people are sitting on the bank boards. You should have cleaned it up by now.
Well, let's ask Mr. Nandkishore Garg from the BJP joins us right now. Mr. Nandkishore Garg, what is your response to Sriram Khanna saying that the finance minister has placed, the ministry has placed weak people on the boards of these banks, because it's the government's responsibility to look after the money? It's taxpayer money. Have you abdicated that responsibility?
I fully agree. It is the responsibility of the government. And government consists of the executives of the finance ministry, RBI and bank officials all including. And as Sriram Khanna is saying, that the government should have done something, and government has done something. First time, how many CMD and CEO has been arrested? Serving CEOs has been arrested, I think, for the first time, right from Syndicate Bank or from PNB or Allahabad Bank. Today, even yesterday, Bank of Maharashtra, previous as well as the serving official has been arrested. This is the what government can do. And government is doing its utmost. Every pie will be recovered. Nobody can escape the wrath of the people. Narendra Modi has zero tolerance towards corruption. It is very easy to say what government is doing. The scam is going on since 2010. And one Gokulnath Shetty has befooled all the... What were they doing? Now, 60 or 70 officers for a PN.
Sir, Mr. Garg, may I ask you a couple of questions, please?
Everybody is now in the clutches of the government. Nobody will be spared. And it is the duty of the government to have Nirav Modi, who anybody, it must be booked, they must be hanged.
No. Let's not talk about hanging people right now for economic offences. May I ask you a couple of questions, Mr. Garg, since you're here representing the government? My first question is, do we know where Nirav Modi is right now? Which country?
Nirav Modi has 6 parts, as you have already described yesterday or day yesterday. Who issued them? It is not the, it is the central government in continuity, officials in continuity. And government doing. They are not getting them out. Foreign ministry or anybody else. But it is the system. Extended to all the things. I think will be now, in 4 years time, you present government. Having all the officers.
I have a problem with the audio of this guest. So I'm going to come back to Mr. Nandkishore Garg in a minute. Mr. Nandkishore Garg, we'll fix that audio. In the meantime, Gautam Mukherjee, senior journalist, do you believe right now that we are losing out as a country? We're talking about 1 lakh crore rupees. That's nearly a point of our GDP, 1% of our GDP. Is this because of crony capitalism, where basically we have big businessmen like Nirav Modi making friends with people who are in power, and they're allowing them to get away with our money?
Well, I think right from the beginning, when the banks were private, were made public, 21 of them, when they were taken over by Indira Gandhi, a patronage system, a political patronage system began. Ostensibly, it was meant to be for, lending to rural sectors and so on, where private bankers didn't want to go. But in practice, it became a process by which, right from the SME level, up to the large companies, up to all sorts of influential people, could help themselves to money, because of whispers and phone calls from politicians. So when we talk of bank boards or RBI boards or even the bureaucrats, we must understand that this, the whole lot of them are minions. And if they rock the boat, they will be punished. This is much bigger than that. And the way it funds itself is in every budget, they put money into the banks again. And that is your taxpayer money. That is the country's money. It is refloated and relooted. This is very big now, but it has been going on from the year dot ever since these 21 public sector banks were set up. And today, every single public sector bank has between 10 and 15% in NPAs, and more being discovered every day. You see, at first they used to have different norms. Now they've brought it down to 50 crores. You know, if 50 crores is outstanding, that's also added to the NPA. And it's just getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Having said that, the total thing of this corruption is still 10% to 15% of the public sector banking system. And so we have to have a sense of proportion. Is, you know, auditors are corrupt. RBI is corrupt. Corrupt by collusion. And, you know, looking the other way, I don't say they're all being paid off.
Yes.
But a lot of them are being told to look the other way, and they're doing it. The finance ministry is the fountain of how these banks are run. In fact, the RBI governor, present RBI governor, Mr. Patel, said, look, I can't do very much because the actual banks are run by the finance ministry. So everybody's passing the buck, but the entire system cannot tackle this kind of corruption because it is fundamentally a patronage system using public money.
A patronage system using public money, that's shocking. It should be shocking to any of us. Sriram Khanna, this is exactly what we're talking about, and put very clearly by Mr. Gautam Mukherjee, that our money is being used for people in powerful places to help out their friends.
And get a slice of the pie for themselves. Let us not assume any altruism here.
Mr. Khanna, please.
See, what he's saying is partially correct. But let me also say that in the last few years, the bank managements, you know, did improve from the 70s to the 80s and over the 90s. But the recent degeneration that we are seeing is more by crony capitalism, that politicians and businessmen who are friends with each other are trying to help each other. But it's not all pervasive, let me tell you. It's selective. So, for example, the people who are close to the ruling dispensation today have been the biggest beneficiaries. And yep. The moment they get caught, then they try to distance from each other. No, they are not aligned to us. But basically, this patronage system has not been challenged because the finance ministry, the Department of Financial Services, is nominating spineless people on the boards of these banks. Who are the people who are nominated? Either the joint secretaries or the additional secretaries of the Ministry of Finance or the cronies of the ruling party. These are the people who have been nominated to the public sector banks
in the last three years. In fact,
not one person with a spine. Had there been any one person, he could have exposed all these things. He could have scrutinized what is going on. So these are people without skills, without spines and without brains, who are also just functioning as centers of patronage.
Yes.
And you want to favor somebody,
you
nominate them in a bank. Learned people, qualified people
are not being nominated.
Sorry,
yes.
No place for you.
There are spokespeople of the ruling disposition.
The Ministry of Finance is doing it.
There are spokespeople, people who come onto television debates and argue, who are being given board seats on public service companies like ONGC. What is the qualification, and why aren't we asking more questions about things like this? Nasir Salim, while the designation I've been given is banker managing partner of Felix Capital, Nasir, we also know that you are part of a political party. You're part of the SP. Let's be honest about that. Now, knowing that you're in opposition, go ahead. What's your point?
So, frankly, the way I see this is, you know, it's not about processes not being followed at the bank. I think it's a larger thing. The larger thing is, and I agree with one of the panelists there who came up and said, that most of these appointments, plush appointments, are driven politically. And I think that is a big challenge here. We need to address that at the first stage. I think clearly, as far as we are concerned, and so as far as the bankers are concerned, I think that should not be compromised fair. Hmm. And clearly, in this particular case, Nirav Modi's case and the PNB bank scam, we saw, processes have been laid out by the RBI. RBI today is in its weakest moments in the last few years, I feel, simply because there's a lot of interference. They themselves have come out in the open and said, we are not responsible for, we can't do enough to regulate PSU senior management banking officials, because we do not have a skin in the game. I think that's the biggest challenge, number one. Number two, I think also clearly, as far as large dispersal of loans are concerned, we've been talking about this from a cleanup perspective. Clearly, you need to have two separate windows. You cannot, bank officials who are the client facing jobs at banks, should not have any interaction with the credit dispersal team. And that is again a big flaw in the current case that we see. In most cases, mostly are driven, most of these NPAs are surmounting on account of PSU banks. We do not see such high number of NPAs with private sector banks. That tells you a story in itself. Clearly, is the fact that these are compromised cases where, if I'm close to a political party, or if I know a particular politician who's senior enough, I go call him and I tell them, sir, I need this particular job or position, and in return, I would actually probably give you a large loan or a large dispersal of a loan. Now, obviously, this is where the buck needs to stop here. And that's where we need to question seriously everyone. Right? So that's my point, Fay.
Absolutely. And, we have one more voice who hasn't spoken. Ashwini Rana represents people working in public sector banks. Mr. Rana, a lot of times it is the employees who are scapegoats. Like in this case, not that I'm saying that this person is, is completely innocent, but are employees being made scapegoats in very, very large scams?
Definitely. This is some different issue. PNB fraud is a different issue. It is a operational and systematical failure. But at the same time, RBI, they have not performed their duty properly. They have not inspected the branch regularly. And moreover, there was all foreign exchange transactions are reported timely to the Reserve Bank. They have not seen what is going on. Secondly, you have to tell that lower level employees are making scapegoat. It is there. Earlier, it was there because the most of the NPA loans, they were decided at the board level, but board people, they were not made accountable. For that, the lower grade people, they were made accountable scapegoat. But now the position has been changed. This, after coming this government, it has been changed. On the board, they have a separate selection system, and there is no pressure on the government bank authorities to give the finance to this corporate or this corporate. So definitely there is a system changed on the top level, and it will take time to come to the down. But banking industry, they are in stress. We have a shortage of workforce for doing all these things. When we give the loan, after giving this loan, there is a process to disbursing, follow up. For that, there is a shortage and shortfall of the workforce. For that, we are not making so many efforts for the follow-up.
So I'm going to ask this one question here at this point from my entire panel, whosoever wants to answer it. And my question is this: should Urjit Patel be asked some tough questions at this point? Should the finance ministry be asked some tough questions at this point? I'll start with Gautam Mukherjee. Is there a failure? All right, Mr. Arjay Dua has his hand up. Mr. Dua, is there a failure right now within the RBI and within the finance ministry?
Yes.
Let me start by saying that the RBI may be making regulations, may be asking the banks to follow certain regulations. The RBI, as it comes out from the PNB case, it is not monitoring whether its instructions and regulations are being followed. Here it says that it's almost trying to wash its hands off by saying that we had in a particular year asked all the banks to integrate their SWIFT system with their own monitoring system, the IT system in the branch. But PNB didn't follow it up. This thing had to come out somewhere, and it would have come out only when the RBI's audit, it may have been at the RBI doesn't necessarily monitor every branch, but when it monitors the bank's operations or when it does branches on a sample basis, this kind of a thing, whether its instructions were being followed about integrating SWIFT with their own IT system, should have come about. I would lay this blame at the doors of the RBI for not following, not monitoring its own instructions. And I would say that the banking operations division, BOD division of the RBI, has not been receiving the kind of attention which it should within the bank itself. One of the major responsibilities of the bank, it might certainly be managing macroeconomic stability, looking at inflationary the macro principles, the macro policy, etc., about rates.
Right.
But it's equally a responsibility, and perhaps one of the bigger responsibilities, that how is the banking system working in the country?
The RBI governor
has talked about his being.
Can I just take a second, the RBI governor may be needing
more powers, but RBI governor could, or RBI could have certainly pointed out that the board of the directors or senior officials of PNB are not doing their job. It may not have been able to take action against them on its own, but it could have said that to the Ministry of Finance. It could have brought it up in its own board, where the Ministry of Finance is represented by three secretaries of the Government of India sit on its board, saying that, look, this is what's happening.
In fact, let me ask these questions of Mr. Nandakishore Garg,
please. I'm not empowered to do it.
Yes.
It did not do it. So I don't think the RBI can wash its hands off.
Absolutely. And if the RBI governor turns around now, Mr. Dua, and says he doesn't have the powers, he's never asked for the powers until today. He's only asking for the powers now when the buck has stopped at his doorstep. Now, Mr. Nandakishore Garg. Mr. Nandakishore Garg, could you tell us currently who is the finance minister of India? Who is functioning in North Block in the finance ministry? Who's in charge at this point today, as of today?
It's a very known fact that finance minister in the North Block used to appoint the CMDs, and they used to ask them to sanction the loans. It was a practice prevalent at that time, and all the NPAs are of that regime in which Mr.
Mr. Garg, I want to understand who is the functioning finance minister of today? Is it Mr. Arun Jaitley or Mr. Piyush Goyal? Who is in the finance ministry today? Who's in charge?
A functional finance minister today is Mr. Piyush Goyal because of the kidney transplant of Mr. Arun Jaitley.
Okay, now tell me, when the chief economic advisor, Mr. Arvind Subramaniam, quit his job yesterday, why did the announcement come from Mr. Jaitley and not Mr. Piyush Goyal?
Because he is still a minister without portfolio, and Arvind Subramaniam has been working with him for the last 4 years, and he just met him through a video conference and told that I want to return to America to meet my family and work with them. He is the most satisfied person, and his term has been over in this June. What is wrong in it?
No problem. I know, because we've just wanted that clarity. I just wanted that clarity. Because a lot of people were confused as to who's the functioning.
Mr. Rajan was the most celebrity.
Yes, no, one second. Mr. Garg, next question. Yesterday, and we're talking right now, and you yourself are talking about it, everybody in this panel agrees that there is a crisis in our banking sector. We've lost 1 lakh crore rupees collectively to scams in the last 5 years. RBI governor says he doesn't have the powers to solve the problems at this point. And the acting finance minister, Mr. Piyush Goyal, was holding a press conference yesterday about how Rohit Vemula's mother was promised money by opposition opposition parties that she had not received. I'm sure there must be more important things for Mr. Piyush Goyal to be looking into in the finance ministry rather than playing politics in this manner. Wouldn't you agree, Mr. Garg?
It is not playing politics, madam. By 15 days, you will see the former finance minister, his son, his wife behind the bar, because they have done all these things which are now coming up below the carpet. Everything will be open to the 125 crore people of this country. The present government is not sparing anybody, how high he may have been holding the position. This is very clear, and everybody should be now concerned that such type of fraud cannot be now done in the present setup. These loans has been given after 2004. Anybody 10,000 crore, 50,000 crore, 60,000 crore, now IBC is playing its role. By December, I think most of the NPAs of the big 12 will be recovered. Everything will be
okay. All right, let me open this up now for people to respond to him. Anyone who wants to respond to what Mr. Garg said, please raise your hand. I can see Ashwini Rana, Vice President of the Bank Officers.
I also agree that the Joint Secretary, Additional Secretary should not be appointed because they have no time to serve the board. And the Chartered Accountants are there. Public nominees are
Mr. Garg, let's be honest about what is happening here. One second, Mr. Garg, let's be honest about what's happening. A massive scam has taken place. 13,000 crore rupees have left our country. Obviously, people knew in the finance ministry, because this much foreign exchange going in and out of the country through multiple banks. You're telling me the finance ministry didn't know? Where is the inquiry into the finance ministry? Where is the inquiry into the RBI officers who looked the other way? Why were they looking the other way? Where is the inquiry into the CMD of Punjab National Bank and everybody else who did not look in the audits? People have let this money go because Nirav Modi was powerful. He had powerful friends. He had a lot of money. Whose money was it? It was my money. It was the money of the person watching at home. And because the government of India, not just this party, every party before that, every government in the past treats taxpayer money like it's some sort of magical piggy bank that they can use and reach into whenever they want to, and there's zero accountability. You are now telling me stories about system failures and technology failures and people not having enough time. I'm sorry, give me my money back. Give me my accountability. Ashwini Rana of National Organization of Bank Workers, do you buy the argument that Mr. Garg is giving us?
Nani, his arguments are right. Most of the thing he has said rightly. But my opinion is, as a RBI governor, Urjit Patel is asking more power. Why they want more? They are having sufficient power. With that powers, what they have done, on every bank board there is a representation of the RBI. What they were doing for this much NPAs, whether they are not accountable, whether RBI nominee or any government nominee has been made accountable for that, at least now some government officials or earlier bank board chairmen or officials, they are being scrutinized, they are being asking, or they are being making accountable. It is now, it has been, this process has been started, but he cannot run away from their responsibility. He is a regulator. As a regulator, he has failed. And so many RBI governors were there. Nobody has for power. They are having sufficient power, but they have not proven their
My argument about the power is simply this. If RBI governor felt he didn't have enough powers, he should have written before the scam and not after it. Gautam Mukherjee, please go ahead.
Yeah, look, earlier I talked of political patronage, which is run via this 100,000 crore worth of banking, public banking system. Now, if we are talking of catching people, if the BJP is talking of being the first ones to actually put people in jail and so forth, we are talking of political will. Political patronage, political will. But beyond this, the question is, does the public sector banking system serve any purpose now? Originally, it was set up to help the poor in the rural areas. Now, in their books, hardly 10% of their money is used for such purposes. They are lending to everybody in the private sector, from the smallest to the medium to the large. And there is a tremendous amount of scamming going on. I come from the private sector. I know for a fact that if you want to scam some money off the banks, go to a public sector bank. Sit down with the manager, agree your bribe, and you're on your way. And there are chartered accountants and there are consultants who prepare documents that look terrific on paper but have no basis in reality. They also make sure that there's no collateral, next to no collateral. What we're talking about is based on balance sheet. Balance sheets in most cases are fraudulent. And then they set up multiple companies, shell companies and so on. All of this also happens in the private sector. And the last point, I mean, having said all this, it's amazing how every one of these people, from the SME to the Malias and the Modis and so forth, get away just in time. They're tipped off, they're let out of the country, and then the investigations begin, and then you hang a few, well, hang meaning you catch a few minions and you sort of rough them up a bit and then let them go too.
Gautam Mukherjee, could there have been people in the finance ministry? Could there have been people up high, as high up as the finance ministry, hand in glove in this particular case?
I would not only say, I'd say every, I'm blaming the politicians squarely, any party. I am saying that every public sector bank, if I'm in Coimbatore, I've got an MLA and an MP who's arranging these things for a kickback for himself. If it's in Delhi, bigger fish, bigger walks, bigger talks, but it's amounting to much the same thing. It is not the actual IAS chap or the IRS chap or so forth. They are on a, well, they're very restricted,
yes,
they're caged,
yes,
parrots. They have to do what they're told or their career goes to hell and worse. It is the politician all the way, MLA, MP, minister, all the way to the top. All the way to the top. There is collusion.
Here's the last question I have before I wrap up this show to my entire panel. Anyone who wants to answer the question, please raise your hand. The RBI, the Reserve Bank of India, is meant to be an independent institution that functions completely independently. It is not supposed to...
There is no independent institution in India anymore. You know, remember Indira Gandhi said, give me committed bureaucrats.
Yes.
And that, everything changed. Has if there ever was an independent institution in India, might have been there in Nehru's time.
So there After isn't. That, so you believe the RBI is now a caged parrot as well, and the RBI
of
is just
course,
doing the government's
there
bidding.
Isn't a single government agency that does not do the politician's bidding. He has no choice.
Anyone who wants to rebut that? Mr. Garg, do you want to rebut that? The RBI is a caged parrot doing the government's bidding. Mr. Dua, go ahead, please.
I don't think it is as simple as that. What we need to be doing is to make sure that going forward, RBI and the Department of Financial Services in the Ministry of Finance, they do not have overlapping powers. RBI should not be allowed to put things at the door.
No, but you know, Mr. Dua, I understand as former finance secretary, you have a keen answer, but I don't want a looking forward answer. Mr. Dua, I don't want a looking forward answer. Everyone from government will tell us, looking forward, we need to make sure this doesn't happen again. I want accountability for the money that has been lost. I want an investigation into the finance ministry. I want an investigation into the RBI.
That is where I'm saying.
Yes.
That the responsibility is today squarely in the bank, Punjab National Bank, and the supervisors of it, which is the RBI. It is not beyond that, and the strictest action for complicity as well as negligence has to be taken by everybody who has let $2 billion of Indian money be siphoned off, most of it outside the country.
All right, Louis on the phone line from Mumbai. Louis, go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead, please.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Go ahead. Good evening.
Yeah, my understanding is all the so much of money is being lost, but banks are losing taxpayers' money. I don't think this is happening without the patronage of the politician. I'm sure about it.
Yeah.
Yes.
That's it. And
yes.
See the event.
It is very easy to say. Role of politician. All the bureaucrats in the Reserve Bank, there is no politician at all.
One second. All right, Louis.
Bureaucrats and bank officials.
No, but Mr. Garg, we just heard Mr. Mukherjee say that this is, that the RBI has become a caged parrot and is just doing the bidding of the government. Yeah. Can you explain to me, if the RBI is an independent institution, how did it clear? RBI, one second, I'll ask the question. Let me ask the question, please. I know when the RBI
and
was established.
There is no politician at all in the Garg. RBI sector.
You know, it's just past the parcel.
RBI is an
Mr. Garg, can you hear? The question is this, Mr. Garg. How did the RBI board clear demonetization in less than half an hour if it was not taking instructions from the government of India?
Two things are very different.
No, they're exactly the same, in fact.
Is the purview of the Prime Minister to eliminate the black money on which the election was fought in 2014.
Even if it was,
brought Modi into the Prime Ministership.
It still needed approval from the RBI board. It could not have been done without approval from the RBI board. And the RBI board cleared it in half an hour. Are you telling me that whoever presented to the RBI board answered all the questions that were asked in half an hour and convinced everybody that this was the best idea? Do we have minutes of that meeting available? Mr. Garg, my question is to you.
You are asking me, madam?
Yes, I am.
Yeah. RBI, these are the policy decision taken by the Prime Minister and the Finance Minister. They are answerable to the people. They are answerable to the 125 crore people who have elected them for eliminating the black money. And for eliminating the black money, demonetization has proved its utility.
So
the
has black money been eliminated?
Has been double in just 1 year. And the more than 5 lakh bogus companies were functioning in this country.
They have been closed down.
And more than 3 lakh more will be closed down. There was a parallel economy in this country. And it is now, everybody knows this government will not spare anybody who is hoarding the black money, doing the all sorts.
Last question. Where is the CAG?
Name a loan which has been given by the present government and which is not now NPA. Not a single person you can name.
Nirav Modi.
All the Nirav Modi has been given not loan. It has been given. Mr. Gokulnath Shetty has been transacting for him for 1,200 times.
So one bank manager transacted 1,200 times and nobody found out about it. He was transferred three times.
Who stopped his transfer?
I'm asking you.
That branch which earned more than 50% earning was given star performer.
Who's supposed to check that? So are you saying that everything that happened in the previous government is that finance minister's fault, but anything that happened in this government is not this finance minister's fault? That's your argument, Mr. Garg.
And that is why Karthi Chidambaram is under lens. He has amassed more than 20,000 crore of rupees. And now everything will be just is a matter of 15 to 20 days.
I'm very happy that you are taking that one case very, very seriously. But I fear you are not paying as much attention to other cases. And that's my worry. Now, here's where the evidence is. Mr. Garg is arguing that the RBI is run by bureaucrats and it has absolutely zero influence from anybody in government. Then in that case, how did demonetization pass through?
Mr. Raghuram Rajan was the most celebrated governor.
And he quit his job and went away.
All the media was praising for him. They want the extension for him.
And then what happened?
Nobody is now questioning him. Every channel was, except Times Now, every channel was for giving him the second term.
What about Mr. Arvind Subramanian? Why did he quit his job and walk away?
Nobody is questioning now.
nobody's listening to him, that's why.
Hello?
All right, I have to wrap up this show right now, but it simply boils down to only one thing. Viewers, in conclusion, I want to thank my guests for joining us. In conclusion, it is impossible for 1 lakh crore rupees, that's 1% of our GDP, 1 lakh crore rupees to have left our country in scams one way or the other through various banks without collusion at the highest levels. All we are asking for is investigations. Investigations that shouldn't stop at a branch manager, branch officer. Investigations into the CMDs, investigations into the RBI offices, investigations into the finance ministry offices that tell us why this is happening. Every learned member of the financial community, including former governors of the RBI, have told us we have a massive problem. What we don't see is attention onto the solution of that problem. And I don't want a forward-looking answer. It's not good enough to say from now onwards we will bolt the stable doors and no horses will get out. We want to know who was responsible for letting this money out to begin with. Show us that same seriousness when it comes to investigation into scams that have happened in this term as you are investigating the scams that have happened in the previous term. That's all we're asking. The RBI should be functioning as an independent authority. It is not functioning as an independent authority, and someone needs to be asking why. Why aren't there more serious questions being asked of the RBI governor, and where are his answers? Where is the inquiry? The citizens of India who are paying for these banks out of our hard-earned taxpayer money deserve better answers. Thanks for watching.